Hi everybody, it's me, Mr. Olson. I'm going to talk to you today about the cell cycle. This includes the cell cycle, mitosis, meiosis, and a little bit about binary fission. So let's go ahead and see what we can do. Before we actually get into the content, I want to make sure I tell you what the content's going to be. Last time we did this, I was able to tell you guys exactly what's going to be showing up in here. These are the main ideas, the main actual standards that I'm supposed to be teaching you. The first one here says, what is the cell cycle and what are the stages and phases of it? There are stages, there are phases. I'll distinguish those while we talk today. We're also supposed to talk about mitosis itself, which is asexual reproduction. We'll talk about meiosis, which is sexual reproduction. We'll also explain how cells regulate themselves and how those mutations can cause cancer. And we're going to compare mitosis and meiosis. And the last thing is we're going to mention some stuff about chromosome numbers. We'll actually kind of do that throughout the presentation. This image does a really good job on showing you what the different stages that we see cells in, or some phases that we see cells in. Inside of here, you can see like there's some nuclei, and those nuclei contain nucleoluses. And you can see these wiggly lines. These wiggly lines are actually going to be the chromosomes that have condensed during the stages of mitosis and meiosis. And hopefully, you're going to be able to identify exactly what stage of life every single one of these cells is in. The cell cycle is considered the regular pattern of growth, replication, and division. A really important part of this is the growth section. Without growth, you're not going to have a cell that's mature enough to actually be able to replicate. When it comes to replication, there's a few methods it could go through. The most common one is going to be mitosis for eukaryotic cells. That's your cells. And the last thing is how they're actually dividing. That's how we actually make our new cells. And we will go into more detail in the division section. When it comes to replication, especially DNA replication, we'll have to do that in a future unit. Now, there are four main stages as part of the cell cycle. That's gap one, synthesis, gap two, and then it finally ends with mitosis, and it'll finally cut with the very last thing called cytokinesis. I want to point out to you that these first three stages are called interphase. Interphase is going to be the main part of a cell's life. They actually spend a majority of time there. I've seen estimates from like 70% to 90% of a cell's life is spent in interphase. It just depends on what kind of cells they are. There are some sections or maybe some cells have some variations of this, which makes them a little bit more unique. So here it is. This is a really good overview of a picture. It shows you interphase. It shows you mitotic phase. And we're just going to start here from the beginning. There's a star that I put here with a start symbol. And we can just kind of keep in mind that we're looking at this one single cell. You can see it has a nucleus inside. It has the regular cytoplasm all around it. And as it's just a cell, it's going to follow along this orange line. That orange line is going to represent interphase, and you can see a huge circle is mostly orange. That orange section is made up of three sections, which we call gap one, synthesis, and gap two. Please remember the sequence of those phases or stages. Gap one, what typically happens is some growth. Gap two also does some growth, and synthesis does something very special called DNA replication, which we'll talk about in more detail here, but in a whole lot more detail when we get into genetics. The very end of interphase is represented with this large M, and the mitotic phase, mitosis, is when the cell divides. We're gonna look at each one of these parts in good detail. Gap one is gonna be when a cell carries out its normal functions. Actually, throughout most of interphase, the cell will be working normally. The only difference is that it grows in size and it makes a lot more organelles. I want to tell you though, a lot of people keep forgetting, the cells perform their normal functions when they're in gap one. This is really important because if the cell doesn't do its normal job, it's not going to be very helpful and your body has no purpose for it. So we want to make sure our cells spend a majority of their time actually in gap one. We also notice this in gap two. I should mention that as well. During synthesis stage, we see cells actually replicating or copying their DNA. They also make sure that there are two complete sets of DNA that are identical to each other. If they make different sets of DNA, well, it's not going to be very good when it comes to splitting that stuff up so we can make two different cells. That's not what we want during mitosis or most of the cell cycle. And if you're ever looking at a photo of cells that are in these stages, you will see that the interior of these nuclei look really grainy, as in fuzzy. They look kind of gray on the inside, which is hard to distinguish anything because there's twice as much DNA as there was before. So looking at our cycle here, we can see we've already talked about G1 and we've talked about synthesis. Next up, we're going to talk about GAP2 and then we'll finish up with mitosis. In GAP2, it's pretty much the same thing as GAP1, except there's some major difference at the end. The cell carries out its normal functions, and it's still going to grow a little bit. But this is also, especially the ending, is where the cell checks to make sure there's not damage, or nothing is damaged for cell division. I have typos here. Deal with it. Sorry. I just managed to always make typos. You know me. I'm not going to change it. Also, I just want to point out, this is kind of where we really regulate that cell growth and division, and that plays a huge role in the development of what we call cancer. So now we've talked about GAP2, I just want to point out, when we're talking about that checking for mistakes phase, this is that region right at the end of GAP2 where we actually check for mistakes. Sometimes cells can slip into mitosis, even though they're mutated or they're changed in some way, and this is how we create cancerous cells. But most of the time, your cells notice a mistake in this range, and then they can send a signal to the cell and say, hey, you're no good, you're just going to hurt me. We need to destroy you and recycle you so we can make better cells in the future. Mitosis has two stages. There's first really mitosis as a stage, which is going to be the division of the nucleus and its contents. So that's the DNA, which we call chromosomes. I'm going to write that there. Also, there's something called cytokinesis. Cytokinesis is going to be when the cell's cytoplasm divides. It's kind of easy to remember because cyto and cyto are shared between the two words there. And kinesis means cutting. So these are really going to cut the cell's cytoplasm, which, and also the organelles that are in the cytoplasm should be moving along with it. After all of this, we should end up with two genetically identical daughter cells. That basically means they have to be the exact same thing. If we make things that are totally different, once again, we can't replace our body parts correctly. So that's a very bad thing. So this is a really, really simple description or diagram of what's going on during mitosis. We can see at the beginning, we have two chromosomes. And what we do is we go through DNA replication. This happens during S phase of interphase. And then now that we've got it doubled up, so when we go to actually divide these things in half, we can actually separate them to opposite sides. So we go through some very organized, very precise stages where we basically split these chromosomes across two different sides of a cell. And you can see that we're going to split the cell in half here, which means we will end up with the exact same thing as what we had at the beginning of this process. That's how you know you're looking at mitosis, when you're making two exact copies. And by the way, these are only involving things called diploid cells, which we'll talk about here in a little bit. I should also point out to you, we have two different main kinds of cells in this world. We have prokaryotic cells and eukaryotic cells. Prokaryotic cells don't really do this process. They go through another one called binary fission, which we'll talk about towards the end of our presentation today. Everything that we're really talking about involves eukaryotic cells, which are your kind of cells, your body's cells. Your cells probably take about 12 hours from S phase to mitotic phase. Any time before that, when they're in gap one, they could be in there for hours, days, weeks, years, and some cells just really never divide, and we'll talk about those. But really, I'm asking the question, what kind of people or animals would you expect to have really fast cell growth? I'll give you a second. Hopefully you've got an answer. Typically what we'll see, like in terms of animals, are probably some animals that you've probably heard of, like a starfish. If you rip off the arm of a starfish, you're actually not going to kill it. It'll actually regenerate that arm, and a lot of the times, that arm can actually develop into a separate starfish. You've probably also thought of something like maybe a lizard. Here in Florida, we have a ton of lizards that are running around, and as a kid, you probably noticed sometimes lizards lose their tails because maybe they were attacked, or maybe some mean kid on the playground pulled off the tail. And those lizards can still survive, and they'll grow their tail again. That is once again using mitosis to create new cells to grow. Humans don't go through that process, I guess kind of unfortunately, because of some genetic factors involved, which we might get to later. But I also want to tell you that humans do use a lot more mitosis when they're growing. So think about early life. You have babies who double in size in about a year or two. You have early childhood experiences, probably all the way through the age of 8 to 10. You're just growing constantly. You never really stop. And then you get another big spurt once you reach adolescence and go through puberty. There is a special exception in this process. I kind of mentioned this earlier, but there are different stages involved in interphase and really the cell cycle. But some specialized cells do not want to divide. When they do not want to divide, especially for a long period of time, we say they go through something called gap zero. It's not exactly gap one or gap two. It's actually basically when the cell starts going through gap one and just kind of hangs out there. It doesn't move on to S phase. It doesn't move on to gap two. It just stays in place and just continues to function like a normal cell. We can see that in our diagram over here. We can see gap zero basically says the cell will start off, it'll go through gap one, and then after a period of time, when it's probably healthy enough to just continually survive, it'll actually get popped out into the cycle and reach gap zero, which is basically maintaining its size. And we just kind of say it just goes back into here and cycles through there. So it just kind of maintains its size. Sometimes it might come out if it's maybe like a liver cell, but most of the time it stays inside of gap one and doesn't really move on unless something physically kills the cell, maybe like old age or death, or maybe even in some cases like trauma, actual damage to the cells. One idea that is something that we talked about earlier in the year is the idea that cells really do need to maintain certain sizes. If cells are too small, they can't contain everything they need to support life within the cell. But if they're too large, they're not going to be able to get enough nutrients to actually maintain that size. Also, if they get too large, many times the cell-to-cell contact with cells next to that large cell will actually identify it as a threat. And they will actually try to eliminate that cell using another process called apoptosis. So now we're going to talk about mitosis itself and only mitosis and cytokinesis. If you remember, if we looked at mitosis as a phase, now we're going to break it down into separate stages. It's a very precise process, and there's a lot going on, and you want to make sure you know this well because, especially for your test, I'm going to ask you to write an essay response question where you have to basically describe exactly what's going on during mitosis and how it ends with cytokinesis. So let's go. Before we can really talk about the stages of mitosis, we do need to mention something called a chromosome. You've probably heard that phrase used before pretty commonly. Chromosomes are long continuous threads of DNA that are kind of broken up into big chunks that help us organize that DNA when we come to divide what's inside of our cells. Humans, and hopefully you're a human, have 46 chromosomes in each of your cells. We say we have 23 pairs. Those 23 pairs are really important for us because they contain different sets of genes, which contain our traits, and they get split up in special ways. Especially when we talk about meiosis, not mitosis, but meiosis, we're going to see why the splitting of those pairs is really important. These long threads sometimes wrap around what we call proteins, known as histones. These are just designed to really pack our DNA into a much smaller area. This is really important because we don't have a whole bunch of space inside of our cells, and if we're going to copy this stuff, we're going to want to make sure there's plenty of room so we can have two sets of genetic information. Now, a long line of your DNA with those histones kind of wrapped up in there are called chromatin. Most of the time, your cell is in gap one. The inside of that nucleus contains chromatin. The DNA is in the shape of chromatin. Only after S phase, and really when we get into mitosis, does it form those chromosomes that we'll see. So let's take a look at what a chromosome actually is. After S phase, we complete a completely new and identical set of DNA, and we start to condense that stuff. It goes from that wiggly, loose shape that we see inside of most of the pictures of cells into these X shapes. One half of this X, and I mean like from a vertical position, from up and down, that is called a chromatid, and that's what this area down here highlights for you. I should also point out to you that there's two different sized arms. The two top arms are called the P arms. I like to think P stands for petite, which means they're very short. And the long arms are the Q arms. These are really going to contain a little bit more information than the top parts when it comes to genes, but you can see how it's wrapped up. All the DNA is wrapped up inside of there. And basically, they're all basically meeting in one area, which we call the centromere. Eventually, when the cell splits, this half of the cell will go one direction, and this half of the cell will go another direction. So it's just kind of important to remember that. I should also point out that there is a size, a small scale over here on the side, and it does point out that we're talking about micrometers, which are extremely small. We're not quite in nanometers, but we are very, very tiny. Okay, I know there's a lot going on in this diagram here, and if you want to, you can hit pause, and when you look at this PowerPoint, you can click each one of these pictures. There's three here, and you can actually expand them and see them in much better detail. I know if we're looking at the presentation in my classroom, you'll probably notice that my projector probably has some coloring problems, and you won't be able to see the detail that I wish you would, but let's talk about it. Up here in the upper left-hand corner, we see something what we call a karyotype. This is actually going to be pictures, photographs of real chromosomes from one person's cells. And inside of here, we can see those 46 chromosomes that we mentioned earlier. They are set up in their 23 pairs. Humans actually have to match them up based on size and shape and color. And you can see they did a good job by lining them up and they numbered them. Our 23 chromosomes are distinguished by different sizes. So you can see you have two single chromosomes here that really pair up and make a single X shape. That is going to be an individual chromosome, which we call homologous chromosomes, by the way. We always want to keep in mind the perspective of what we're talking about. I tried to show you a picture earlier where I was talking about the size, the scale of what's being shown there. I think this image on the right side does a really good job because it shows you what DNA looks like, which looks kind of like a ladder, and it's a twisted up ladder. Well, if we pull back from that view and we start looking at it at from a wider perspective, the DNA looks like a small thread, and then that small thread will start to wrap around those little proteins, which we called histones. As soon as they start wrapping around in there, we end up with this stuff, and it'll kind of curl up thanks to those protein shapes, and we form that cool shape that looks like an old phone cord. I know most of you don't deal with wired phones, but they used to be a thing, especially back in the 90s. And they curl up, and that's what we call chromatin. And then that chromatin can condense into the shapes of the X that we see up here. And we can see that it's the chromosome shape that we know and love. Down here on the bottom, I just wanted to show that in a little bit different perspective. You can see you have your DNA over here on the left side, and then we actually look at the real strings on a thread, or beads on a string is the phrase they use here. That's actually going to be the histones wrapping around what we know as our DNA. And then they form their basic shape, and then after they start to form up, they can actually organize themselves and wrap themselves up so they become very condensed, and you can see how condensed it is over here, that they form those X shapes that we're so familiar with. Now, we're going to talk about the stages involved in mitosis. Now, I always give kids some goofy reminder, and some teachers in the past have said something similar, but I'm going to make up my own, and it's going to be kind of gross, but whatever. This is what I say. The first thing we always use in the cell cycle is the letter I. That represents interphase, which is made of gap 1, synthesis, and gap 2. After that, we come up with something called prophase. Then we follow it with metaphase. then anaphase, then telophase, and then the very last thing we must do is we must go through cytokinesis, which actually cuts the cell in half. IPMATC. You could remember just six letters in a line like that, but I like to make a little story to go along with it. Pretend, and I know this is gross, but pretend you're now standing in front of your friends and family and you've told them you have a very important announcement. You are going to inform them that you have done something terribly, terribly disgusting. Are you ready? Just remember, you're standing in front of everybody and you tell them, I peed on a mat. See? I know that seems goofy, but you're basically telling them, IPMATC. If you are peeing on a mat, and I mean like urinating on a small mat on the ground, I know that's disgusting, whatever, it's gonna stick in your brain. I happens before prophase, prophase happens before metaphase, metaphase happens before anaphase, anaphase before telophase, and telophase is finally ended with cytokinesis. Please remember those stages. In class, I kind of gave you that analogy there, that little story, and I know it's funny, but it really will help. It will help you remember the stages of mitosis. So let's look at what happens on the inside of the cell during prophase. Chromatin is now going to condense into those X shapes that we're so familiar with. I like to think they look like little people there. They have their little waist. That's what the white dot represents inside, like this red chromosome here. We can also see that they have their long legs and their shorter arms. So I like to think they're like little children. This will play a role, and once again, it'll get very weird. The nuclear envelope, or the nuclear membrane, will start to break down, and you can see like they're really starting to have a lot of gaps here because they're starting to loosen up totally. You can even see the nucleolus is going to start to disappear. The spindle fibers will grow, and if you look on the left side of the cell, you can see these long threads, these long fibers. Those are called spindle fibers, and they're connected to these things called the centriole. The centriole is going to be here, and the spindle fibers, oh, that's super confusing. Let's do centriole. There we go. And then the spindle fibers are going to be here. We have two sets of centrioles. They're going to move to opposite sides of the cell. The spindle fibers will remain attached to them. And the job of the spindle fibers is going to really be doing the work of division by pulling apart the chromosomes. There are also these things called asters. They're like little hairs that kind of grow off of the centrioles there. And they kind of help structure or anchor down the centrioles. Once we've gone through prophase, those chromosomes have now total freedom to move around inside of the cell because there's no longer a nucleus. And those are going to line up in the middle. And I know this is kind of approximate, but they're roughly going to line up in a line like this in the middle. And you can see those spindle fibers from the centrioles are going to reach out and they're going to try to grab the middle of those cells. I'm sorry, the middle of those chromosomes. They're attaching to what we call the centromere of the chromosome. They're in the center, so that's kind of easy to remember. The analogy I use for this is going to be like these giant spiders. Spindle fibers are the spider legs. And they're going to try to eat the children. So they want to capture the children before they can actually eat them. I know, once again, I'm a very gross person. But deal with it, okay? The chromosomes are going to be lined up in the middle, and each spider wants one half of the kid. So they'll rip them apart from the middle. Each spider will grab a part of the middle, and they'll rip the child in half and bring those opposite sides to the opposite sides of the cell. Once again, please do not hate me for my gross analogies. So here is anaphase. Anaphase, because the kids are getting ripped in half. They're going to scream out in pain. The chromatids will now separate. We use the phrase chromatids because we said one half of that chromosome, that X shape, is called a chromatid, and that's a number of slides back. The spindle fibers, the spider legs, are now shortening. They're kind of getting reeled up by those centrioles, which is a pretty amazing little process. And those parts will now move to opposite sides of the cell. You can also see in our diagram over here, we have a bunch of mitochondria, which have been replicated and produced, and they're now going to separate as well. That really finishes up here in telophase, which is coming up next. Telophase is when those two sets of nuclear material have finally divided. You can see the X shapes aren't really X shapes anymore. You only have your half of an X, and now they start to unravel and unwind. They start to go to that normal chromatin shape that we're familiar with. You can see the nucleolus is going to start to reform. You can start to see there's some more structure happening here because the nucleus will start to reform. And we can see there's a healthy amount of organelles on both sides, which tells us the cells should be able to replicate in the future. Now, the cells haven't actually finished dividing after telophase. They still need to go through a process of cytokinesis, and that's going to be the actual cutting of them here. I just want to point out to you, cytokinesis is very brief, and it does not divide the nucleus. It's only the division of the cell itself, like the cell's cytoplasm. You can now see, once we get a, we've now created two brand new cells. They're exactly the same thing. And you can even see on the inside of this first cell here, you can see there's a long purple line and a short purple line, a big orange line and a short orange line. Those represent the chromosomes that we have just made. Those chromosomes can now be basically just thrown back inside of new cells, and they're going to be allowed to replicate and reproduce new cells in the future. It's really the cycle of life. And this is an important thing to notice. Mitosis is a cycle, okay? It does repeat itself. And that's also true of the other cell that's produced. I know this diagram over here shows them going off and maybe to gap zero, but the truth is this one could just as easily go off and go into mitosis as well, meaning we have two cells now going through mitosis. Please try to make sure, guys, you always remember, mitosis can certainly repeat itself, and it usually does. If you want a little bit of a more of a cheat sheet version, I can just point you in this direction. Basically, it goes over the highlights, the main points that are going on during mitosis. I want to actually tell you there is a special stage in here that we didn't really talk about because our standards don't actually say we have to talk about it, but I'm going to tell you about it because I should. There's something called prometaphase, which happens in between prophase and metaphase, and really it kind of makes sense because this is a sequence. It doesn't mean like they click into place. It actually means that they just flow into their new positions. So since it's more flowing and the space in between prophase and metaphase is quite dramatic, we want to make sure we can represent that with prometaphase. So you can look down on the bottom and you can see some fluorescent microscopy that actually shows you what's going on there. It does a really good job in showing what they look like. I've also got some pictures here that I can show you what is happening during mitosis. Now, once again, you can see we've now gone through prophase. That's really through early prophase would be A. We can start to see B being really prometaphase. You can see the green things, the spindle fibers are really expanding. In C, you start to see them really lining up and they're starting to form towards the middle. In D, they're really aligned. You can see the spindle fibers are really starting to separate. In E and F, you can start to see them actually pull apart. And G, you can see what we call telophase. And then in H, they're just about separated, very late telophase, and cytokinesis is just now cutting those things apart. So we can see A through H here, it's more fluid of a process than just the stages represent. So please don't go thinking they click into place like little pictures, okay? They flow. In this diagram here, you can just kind of test yourself and see if you know what each stage looks like. We saw some examples earlier. Number one, what do you think the stages for this cell? Number two, number three, and number four. When you click the next slide, you're going to be able to see the answers revealed. And here they are. We have prophase up there in the top right corner, metaphase coming next. You can see how the chromosomes are lining up in the middle here. We have anaphase, that's third. You can see them really starting to separate from each other. And telophase, you can even start to see in this line right here, they are starting to divide, which is a nice thing to see. So now that we've talked about mitosis, let's go ahead and throw something else your way. It's a lot like mitosis. It's almost the same thing, but it's got some major differences because it helps make sex cells, and we'll talk about those differences here. I know we're jumping ahead in a chapter. This is going to be chapter 6, section 1, and everything we just talked about was in section 5, and we are going to jump back to section 5 or chapter 5, but I want to talk about this first. So there is a difference between sexual reproduction and asexual reproduction. First off, sexual reproduction only takes place when the cells designed for that purpose basically are trying to make genetically different cells. This involves sex cells, which we call gametes. Those gametes are only formed inside of mammals as either sperm or egg. So sperm are made by men and eggs are made by women. And these make haploid cells. And we're going to talk about haploid cells here in a second. Most of your body, though, reproduces and, you know, repairs and grows with the process of mitosis. So that means everything up here is going to be involved with meiosis. And everything down here is going to be using mitosis. Now, this includes your body cells. And I mean literally your body's cells. We call them somatic cells. I mean like your heart cells, your nose cells, your knee cells, and your toe cells. So your toeses grow with mitosis. That's funny. So all of your body cells are also going to be known as diploid cells. So let's dive in and find out what haploid and diploid actually means. So you can see the difference here is that haploid cells have half the information that a diploid cell was. When we look at this red chromosome here, we can see that they're basically, we have two sets of the same shape and the same size. We can also see for the blue ones, up above we have only one chromosome, down here we have two chromosomes. Most of the time we're going to be able to see these can duplicate, and this is how we actually divide our cells in meiosis. These two chromosomes will form together and they'll replicate. We'll end up with two X's with some slight differences there, and we'll exchange them. So when it comes to reproduction within meiosis, you get one haploid cell from your mom and one with from your dad, and those different kinds of haploids really create the variety that we see in life. So that makes a genetically different diploid cell than your parents' two haploid cells. This makes sure that you look similar to your parents, but you're not exactly the same, which basically means we show change, we evolve, and this really supports the idea of evolution as well. So just to show you, there is a connection between meiosis and mitosis. Meiosis makes four haploid cells, and you can see on the left side of our diagram right here, starting here, we have four genetically unique or not identical haploid cells. Those haploid cells, we can see, have small variations, but we need two haploid cells to go through a process called fertilization. One from mom, that's a female symbol, and one from dad. They come together in that process called fertilization, and basically the egg and the sperm meet together. Once that happens, we can go through mitosis, and we can continually make a lot more cells. So you started out as one single cell, and eventually that'll turn into two cells, and then that will turn into four cells, and then that'll happen until you reach the trillions and trillions of cells that you are. Finally, once you reach your own sexual maturity and you start making your own sex cells, or you can start maturing your sex cells, you can go through meiosis to make those cells and eventually release those and maybe make another future person. Now, there, once again, like with mitosis, there's two phases that we see here. In this case, though, we're really looking at meiosis 1 and meiosis 2. Now, there are very precise processes. They're almost just like what we see in inside of mitosis. I'm going to write this out for you. Remember our last example? We said we had something called interphase, and then we go through prophase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase, and cytokinesis. Well, this actually happens twice. So with meiosis 1, we go interphase, PMAT, C, and since we've divided the cell, we need to divide it one more time because we split our cells into four cells when we go through meiosis. So after we go through the first cytokinesis, we go right back into prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase, and another cytokinesis. So that's our four cells. So meiosis 1 is I, PMAT, C. And then meiosis 2 is PMAT-C. Since it's meiosis 1, sometimes I like to write down that there's a little 1 after these guys right here. So if we ever need to distinguish what happens between different stages, we know exactly which stage it is. And in this case, that means there's a little 2 written behind these guys like this. Cytokinesis just means splitting, so I don't usually put a number there. And interphase only happens once, and that, of course, must happen in meiosis 1. So I, PMAT-C, PMAT-C. Down here, you can see the example. We have some chromosomes set up for us. We have a cell, a diploid cell, and we're going to make haploid cells, which means it should end up different than what we see here at the end. The ones different at here at the end only have half the information. They only have one of these large chromosomes and only one of these small chromosomes, which tells us they need to match up with another kind of sex cell so we can have a full set of information. Anyway, we start off with a diploid cell, which we say is called 2N. That's the chromosome number, 2N. And eventually, they'll go through interphase, which we call S phase, and that's synthesis phase, and then they will make their genetic copies. Once that happens, they will line up, and we're going to talk about this. When they line up, you can see some colors get exchanged. That's different than what we saw in mitosis. In meiosis, they exchange some parts and pieces there, and then they will split in half once, which we call meiosis 1, and then they'll split apart again, which we call meiosis 2. So we're going to have two stages of cell division, and once again, we're going to have some cool stuff happen in meiosis 1, which we call, and that's written up here, independent assortment and crossing over, which we'll go into in here just in a little bit. So this looks a lot similar to the example that we saw earlier. This is on meiosis, but it is not a cycle. It just happens once. So we start off with our diploid cells. We can see that number there. We got 2N, so that tells us it's diploid. We got one large purple, one short purple, one large orange, one short orange. And then we go through interphase. We copy it, and that's interphase S phase. And then we go through prophase 1. You can notice that now these things are hugging each other. They're really not lining up. They're actually hugging each other, and you can see there's some purple and orange exchanging locations. And then they go through metaphase, and they'll actually start to segregate, which we call independent assortment, and I'll talk about that here in a second. Then they pull apart in anaphase 1, and then they separate, and they start to reform a nuclei. That's in telophase 1. Now you can see we only have half the information. That's why we don't have 2N anymore. Now we only have a single N in these cases. And then we go through prophase 2, then metaphase 2, and then anaphase 2. I should also point out, crossing over and independent assortment don't occur in metaphase 2 or prophase 2 because they've already had that genetic variation added. So now they can just move forward and just split. I usually like to think meiosis 2 is just like mitosis in the fact that it just splits those cells or those chromosomes in half. Then we go through telophase 2, and we end up with 4 unique cells. And if you actually look really closely inside of there, every single one of those cells is represented by N, not 2N, but N. And we have a large purple, and let's say in this case, we have a large purple and a short orange, but you can see there's just a little bit of purple on that orange. Over here, you can see that we have a large purple and a little orange, but there's a little bit more orange mixed in with that purple, and that creates that genetic diversity, that genetic variation, which increases survivability in future generations. So here we can see crossing over. I like to use this example. Imagine you have an aunt that you never see. Maybe you just saw her at Thanksgiving this year. And she's so excited to see you. She grabs you and she hugs you. But it turns out she's one of those crazy aunts that has like a lot of cats. And she wears old lady perfume. And she just kind of smells funny. Well, she's hugging you so close. And you're kind of grossed out. And she's kissing you. Oh, baby, I miss you. She's kissing you, and then she finally lets you go. You walk away, and you're covered in cat hair. You're covered in old lady makeup, and you smell kind of weird. That's going to be an example of crossing over. Those chromosomes, those similar chromosomes, which we call homologous chromosomes, line up next to each other, and they hug, and they exchange some genetic information. Not all of it, just some of it. And this, what it does is it leaves behind sections of the other with each chromosome. So this basically means while the chromosomes are similar, they're not exactly the same, and now they have a lot of genetic variation. So when they finally split apart from each other, they take a little bit of each other with them, which means we get some mixing of traits, which is very good. And by the way, this only happens in meiosis 1. If we look at this diagram, which is part of a larger picture, which I'll show you here in a second, we can see a left side and a red side. So let's right now just focus on the red side. Looking at this, we kind of segregate our chromosomes. So finally, they double up, they go through S phase, Okay, so we start off with a diploid cell. We double up our information, and then that information is basically going to it's going to have those little X's. I know they're not X's here, but stick with me. And we know that information is going to get split in half. So up and down in the cell, we're going to split those chromosomes up. But before we do that, before we separate them, we don't actually split them. We separate them. We could see one side of the cell is going to end up with two purples. That's going to be after meiosis one. And we can see this side is going to end up with two red chromosomes. After we go through meiosis two, we can actually now split those chromosomes, split them in half, and we can see we will end up with a large and a small purple chromosome and a large and a small purple chromosome over here. But over here, we're going to end up having a large and a small red chromosome for each of these. But isn't it possible, isn't it just as possible that instead of the chromosomes lining up so that they go from big to small, purple, red, couldn't they have gone purple, red, purple? If we look over here, we can see our bottom two small chromosomes, now we're on the blue side, are in a different position. So if we look at that and we split our cell in half just like we would, we can see we end up with purple and red over here, and then we on the right side we have a red and a purple. You're probably saying, well, they both have purple and red, they're the same thing, but look at the sizes, guys. We have a big distinction, a big difference here. And remember, we don't just have two chromosomes inside of our cells. We have 23 pairs of chromosomes. So even if just one chromosome moves over to one side, that creates a good deal of genetic variety. And don't forget, crossing over also happened here. So we can end up with a lot of unique haploid cells through just moving one chromosome, let alone 23 in random orders. This is that larger diagram that really describes what we're going to be talking about in the future. And we can basically see, we'll be able to predict what future offspring will look like using some pretty simple genetic principles, which we call a Punnett square. This is going to be called a dihybrid cross. But don't panic, don't worry. We'll get to that here in just a little bit. Once again, you should be able to name the stages of meiosis. Of course, we start off with something called interphase, and then in S phase of interphase, we double it up. And then after interphase, we go through P, M, A, T, C. And then after we go through that stage of cytokinesis, we once again divide. So we go back through P, M, A, T, and our final stage of division. And we said since it's meiosis one and meiosis two, we like to put little ones behind these letters and a little two behind these letters to show us the very precise stages, but basically how there's two forms of division. And if I look here in my diagram, this is going to be S phase. I know we've done this a lot. We're going to have like prophase and metaphase. That's going to be really prophase and metaphase one. And then they're going to split. This is going to be meiosis one. And then we have these two separate cells. They'll go through PMAT again, and this will be meiosis two. Okay, so just try to keep that in mind. It's like mitosis, but twice, and there's some cool stuff happening, especially crossing over and independent assortment. So let's talk about some of the more real life, the real results of the cell cycle, which we consider the regulation of the cell cycle. This will be chapter 5, section 3, and really relates to what we call cancer. In this picture, you can see this is a person that's been affected by leukemia. Leukemia affects the red blood cells in a person. Red blood cells are designed to carry around oxygen and carbon dioxide. These are kind of the normal cells. They're the light color, they look small, they look round, everything's great. They work properly. But when it comes to these other cells, they're very dark, they're greater in size, they look gigantic, and they look misshapen. They're not totally right. Those are going to be the leukemia cells. They're not going to carry oxygen and carbon dioxide the way they're supposed to, and this results in some pretty terrible health conditions for the person that's affected by it. Here we can see some nerve cells that are affected by this. You can see that there are some misshapen cells here, and they are not going to be working properly. So basically, if we have some misshapen cells and they're allowed to replicate, we create what we call cancer. So how do we end up with these misshapen cells? How do we make these mistakes? They do happen. How come not everybody has cancer? So let's talk about it. There are some factors that control cell division. First off, we know that cell division is controlled by external and internal factors. External means outside, and internal means inside. That means there's things inside of cells that help control what they do, and there's things outside of cells which control what they do. If we don't control cells in some way, they're going to grow out of control, and they're not going to work properly. So let's talk about some of those external factors. There's really two kinds that we know. We have chemical and we have physical factors. Physical factors are going to be basically cell-to-cell contact. So let's say down here, we've got a cell that's among a whole bunch of cells here, right? And they usually are really, really close to each other in vicinity. But over time, let's say one of these cells has a problem and it's going to get a signal and it's just going to keep on growing. So that cell is going to get really big and those other cells are going to have to rub up against it. And it seems like when it comes for fighting for survival, that bigger cell is going to cause a lot of problems. So sometimes when a cell touches another, it's going to get a signal like, no, don't get too big, stay the same size. So hopefully they can all compete for the same resources the same way. They can all receive everything they need. This is bad. This is a bad situation. This does not work out. And if this does happen, a lot of the times the cells around it will send a signal to that cell, activating a self-destruction sequence. So it goes bye-bye. It destroys itself. Another kind of external factor isn't just a physical contact, but actually a chemical contact. A really common one is called a growth factor. There's tons of chemicals out there, and pretty much any chemical that comes in contact with your cells can be an external factor. You can affect your cells with all kinds of chemicals. That's the idea behind medication. We give you a certain kind of chemical that makes your cell act a different way. Different factors have different effects. Some growth factors, which are pretty commonly known as HGH, human growth hormone, that tells your cells to keep growing. You develop this throughout your life, but if you're a professional athlete or something, you can illegally obtain some of this stuff and use it during your games, and you can maybe get an edge on your opponents because your cells can recover very quickly. I'm not condoning this. I'm basically saying these chemicals work throughout your lifetime and they cause pretty much the same reaction as you move forward. So in the most basic sense, this is kind of how cells communicate with each other. We have these molecules on the outside of a cell. That's what extracellular means, or excellular fluid means. That means outside of the cell, there's these things called ligands. Ligands are just chemicals. It can be any kind of chemical. It could be epinephrine, HGH. It could be morphine. It could be any kind of chemical. And if that comes in contact with our cell's membrane, which has a bunch of proteins on there, which we said sometimes act as receptors, they can receive these signals, and then once they do that, they can trigger what we call an intracellular response. It's a very complicated process here. Most of the time, these involve things called G proteins. If you want to know more about it, take AP Biology and you'll learn all about it. All right. So some of those growth factors might attach to the receptor of a cell, and that's the signal that tells the cell's nucleus, hey, it's time to divide in two. And you'll notice on the outside of the cell, there's all kinds of different receptors because there's all kinds of proteins on the outside of your cells. Please remember that. Those things are really important. Sometimes there's internal factors that change how a cell acts. A lot of the times, those are going to be called kinases and cyclins. I assigned you guys to watch a video from Bozeman Science. Paul Anderson makes this video, and he actually describes exactly what kinases and cyclins are. I recommend you watch it because I assigned you to watch it. But basically, these are proteins that once they build up over time inside of a cell, they really trigger the response for the cell to start going through the stages of mitosis. Without those proteins, nothing will actually function. Nothing will actually work. So there's this cool phrase out there. It's called pre-programmed cell death, also known as apoptosis. Basically, you can have outside or inside factors that actually turn on this self-destructive enzyme. These are proteins that are literally designed to destroy the cell. It can usually be part of a cell's normal function, especially if a mistake is noticed in that cell cycle and it's like, hey, I don't want to make this mistake happen again. Let me get rid of the cell so we can replace it with something that's actually healthy. A lot of the times, if you If you think about what happens in somebody who passes away from old age, their cells were working just before, and for some reason they just stopped working. And that's probably because there's a mass moment where a whole lot of apoptosis occurred in maybe their heart or their liver or their kidneys. And that kind of explains how basically old age plays a role. I mention this because there's actually a lot of ongoing research currently trying to fight off what we know as basic early termination of cells. And there's some pretty cool stuff going on there. So a good Google search will go to show you. Apoptosis is trying to be understood and maybe reversed or fought off in some way. But most of the time it's necessary because we do need to repair our cells. And the only way we can repair them is if we get rid of the broken parts. And that's what this does. So talking about all that stuff really finally gets us to the idea of cancer. Cancer is considered uncontrolled cell growth. It basically means there's no regulation in the cell cycle, so it's just going to continue to make bad copies of that cell. Cancers can come in two forms, or really tumors can come in two forms, which we call benign or malignant tumors. Benign cancers are basically going to be when the cells stay together and they remain fairly harmless. I'm not saying benign cancers can't be dangerous. They certainly can. Let's imagine one forms on near your pituitary gland in your brain. That's going to cause some major instability. It's going to put a lot of added pressure because you'll be increasing tissue area, and that would be pretty bad. But most of the time, they're fairly, you know, non-eventful. Malignant cancers, on the other hand, are the very bad versions of cancer. This is when they can actually break away from a lump and spread to other parts of the body. That phrase that we use for spreading is called metastasizing. That's an important thing to remember because that's what makes these so bad. If you want help remembering malignant and why it's so bad, think about the Latin root of the word, which you may or may not be familiar with. M-A-L, mal, actually means bad. In this diagram, you can see we have some normal cells on the left side, and we can see a slow progression of how these cells might develop into what we call a cancer, or different stages of a cancer. You can see the cells are very organized and precise in stage one, but in stage two, we start to see that they're starting to look irregular. They don't look totally normal, and that's because the cell with the mistake was allowed to replicate and make more cells that have that same mistake, and it starts to look very uneven. In stage three, we can start to see the cells all look in various sizes and different kind of different states of repair. They start to look very abnormal. Finally, we can end up with a carcinoma, and that's going to be what we know as like a tumor. It's a lump of, you know, really, really misshapen cells that are just like not doing the job that they're supposed to, because these guys aren't really functioning at all, and that's what's so dangerous about cancers. And then finally, we can see here on steps five right here, we can see these cells have now decided to spread throughout the body. This is what we call an invasive cancer, and that's what happens with metastasis. Looking at these pictures, we can see a cell in its normal stages of mitosis. Actually, this is going to be basically metaphase. But looking on the right side, we can see some variations that can happen within cancer. Cancer cells might have what we call a lagging chromosome. You can see in the middle here while they're starting to separate. They're not really pulling apart too well there. They're pretty much lagging behind. Over here we can see arrested mitosis, which basically means it stays in mitosis. We said earlier, way earlier, we said cells in mitosis aren't really busy trying to do anything because they're too busy trying to divide. Interphase is where cells act normally, and this cell is never going to go back to interphase. Then we have multipolar mitosis, which is basically trying to split the cell in multiple ways, and it can only split in two, so it really causes a major problem, really creates a lot of damaged cells. So cancer cells, remember, will not carry out their normal functions, and that's why cancers are considered so dangerous. They really cause entire tissues to shut down, and this is why invasive cancers in different parts of the body are so dangerous. That's why early treatment and detection is key, so maybe those cancer tumors can be detected and removed and treated properly well before they have a chance to spread. Cancer is usually caused by damage or mutation that occur inside of the cell. This can come from a lot of places, but most of the time they're known as carcinogens. Carcinogens that are really common, ones that you're very familiar with, are going to be cigarette smoke or really tobacco products. These are known to cause a lot of issues when it comes to developing cancer. There's also a common substance that was used in the mid-20th century and early 20th century called asbestos, and that can cause mesothelioma that's in the lungs. And basically, it was an insulator that was spread around all over the place because it was an awesome insulator, but it also by chance, had a high chance of, causing major problems inside of cells that could lead to cancer. So once again, looking at this picture of, what we see as leukemia cells, I just want to point out to you guys, like these cells can spread. That's why they're so dangerous. And it's very dangerous within a blood cancer because, that means the blood is shared between all parts of the body. So the blood needs to be treated itself. It's kind of like the highway within the body. And we're actually going to talk about, what blood structures there are, later in the year towards the end. Just really quickly, I want to tell you about another form of asexual reproduction called binary fission. Reproduction can come in two forms. As you'll remember, we have sexual and asexual. Sexual is going to be the joining of gametes, gametes from each parent. And asexual means there's no gametes. It's only an offspring from one parent. Asexual is a diploid cell. And we know that sexual cells involve haploid cells. So please don't forget that. We need to know the differences between sexual and asexual reproduction. Also, binary fission. Fission means cutting. It's splitting. If you've ever heard of a nuclear power plant, they're called fission power plants because they split atoms. They don't fuse them together. They split them. So this is how actually most prokaryotes reproduce. And I already mentioned this way early. It's a form of asexual reproduction. And it results pretty much into two cells that are the same. So it's kind of like mitosis, but it's really different because it just kind of pulls itself apart and brings half the DNA with it. So let's look at a picture of that. Inside of the cell, you can see there's a ring of DNA. We can see that ring of DNA is going to be kind of wrapped up really well, and it'll condense. It won't condense into the chromosomes that we're familiar with, but it'll condense, and then basically they'll go through S phase of the cell cycle, and then they'll make a copy of their DNA. But basically, they don't like separate it. They don't use spindle fibers. They have no centromeres. They really are just going to split it in the middle here, and basically that's all they do is they start separating their different sides, and they just pretty much just hope this chromosome stuff will stay over here and this DNA will stay over here so that when they split and make two cells, they have the genetic information required. When we're comparing binary fission to mitosis and meiosis, we can see there's some major differences here. Binary fission is just DNA replication, chromosome segregation, and then cytokinesis. That's it. That's all they really do. Whereas we have a lot of cool stuff happening over here in mitosis. We said we got our diploid cells that go through S phase, and then they got to go through prophase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase. That's all asexual reproduction. The same kind of stages are used in meiosis, but once again, meiosis has two stages of cell division. It also has, what we call crossing over and independent assortment taking place. And we can see it also makes haploid cells instead of diploid cells. So this is really your chance to be able to compare them side by side and say, okay, mitosis has its differences, meiosis has its differences, and they're both really totally different than binary fission. This would be a good chance for you to write out your differences between mitosis and meiosis. Also, here they are, the differences between binary fission and mitosis. Binary fission, once again, no nucleus division because prokaryotes don't have a nucleus. There's no spindle fibers, and they have a lot less DNA because they're less complex organisms. Mitosis, though, they divide the nucleus, they use the spindle fibers, and they have a lot of different chromosomes instead of just that one circular form of DNA. There is an advantage, though, to binary fission. These organisms could have been some of the earliest ones living on Earth. Basically, if you live in a particular environment, you don't need to change, which is why we don't need genetic diversity. Think of it like a bacteria, like E. coli. It's evolved to live in certain conditions really, 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 really well. But basically, their motto is, if it's not broke, don't fix it. Basically, they don't need a partner, so they can just make copies of themselves, and they all pretty much make the same kind of cell, so they can all live in the same environments. This is good, but there's also a disadvantage. And the disadvantage would be that if those conditions that the organisms live in change, well, then they might die really easily. Also, since they have such low genetic diversity, it really lowers their chances of finding a better version of themselves so they can evolve and change and adapt into something cool. E. coli organisms haven't changed much over millions and millions and millions of years. But when we think about humans, they've certainly changed a lot in a relatively short amount of time. Just talking about eukaryotes again, they can do something kind of special that's a little bit different than just mitosis. There's something called budding, there's something called fragmentation. I'm not going to require you guys to know this on a test, but I thought it was just kind of interesting. Basically, budding is when a small organism grows off of the parent organism and drops off, or sometimes it stays attached. And fragmentation is basically when the parent splits into pieces and each piece becomes a new organism. That's kind of like the starfish we were talking about. And some organisms can reproduce both sexually and asexually, so that's kind of neat. Here you can see like some of those organisms that reproduce that method. We have some hydra on the left side here, and we have some starfish on the bottom. Just keep in mind, guys, these are basically going to be the budding methods. And then down here, we can see the fragmentation.